Hi, I'm Newtone. Welcome to my studio just outside Cambridge. I'm going to talk to you about a tune of mine called Tides. So I first started making music with computers around 1992 with an Atari ST, a Roland General MIDI module and a controller keyboard. And none of that music still exists, which is probably for the best. But it was basically, learning how to program MIDI, I guess, was kind of what I started with that. And then went to university, studied music, but specialised in electroacoustics. And so really got into, I guess, working in the studio at that point. Everything was tape, reel-to-reels. Not that it was all reel-to-reels back then, but that was just how they did it with us. And so we had to kind of learn how to edit tape together. And then eventually when we got to our second year, we were allowed to go into the upper studio where they had Digital Performer. On a Mac, which was the first real kind of DAW that I used, at least that handled audio. And it wasn't very conducive to anything particularly, but interesting. Learned to kind of use Pro Tools at the same time. They had that upstairs as well, and a bunch of interesting external hardware, like loads of external processing that came from, supposedly, from the BBC Radiophonic Workshop. So it was all kind of handmade filter banks and EQs and all this kind of stuff. And then eventually, Reason came out, and also Cubase VST5, I think. Or no, it's just Cubase VST, sorry. Cubase VST, which was the first version of Cubase that handled audio, had, and also had virtual instruments. And at that point I realized, you know what, I'm going to be able to do this without a huge rack full of gear. All I need is a computer, some speakers. And so shortly after that I quit my teaching job, got myself a computer that was powerful enough to do what I needed it to do, and started making music kind of full time, really. Around the time that Cubase VST came out, I'd used Logic, I'd used Pro Tools, I'd used Digital Performer, I'd used Notator on the ST. I was using Reason a little bit as well. But Cubase was the only one that I really felt comfortable with. In terms of the way that I write, Reason's great for beats. Cubase, I still use for all my vocal recording. I use for a lot of the soft synths. And all of the mix down, basically. So to start with, I guess I'll play you the at least the first bit of the tune so you can get an idea.
Oh,
that gives you an idea of what's going on there. Basically, the tune is built up around a little loop made up of like a celeste and a harp. And the idea for that came from just a little sample. And so I just kind of took that idea that's just straightforward contact kind of factory sample set, like a harp and a celeste. And those are, I think, if I remember correctly, programmed as triplets. So, yeah, basically crotchet triplets or quarter triplets. So, tune just starts with those and a high string. And then I originally just let those play and messed around on a piano patch. And I think it's the Alicia's Keys one. Yeah. So just the Alicia's Keys piano, which is, it's really nice and rich, kind of deep, sonorous piano. And came up with the chord structure that sits underneath that. And that then kind of suggested strings. So those I kind of played in, built them up there. I think those were using, the cinematic strings set, which is big, but has a really nice kind of rich sound to it. So I played in the kind of the violins, first and second violins, violas, cellos, basses on separate channels on here. So you can get a nice kind of voice leading the way that the different parts kind of lead from one note to the next. And then at the end there, you can hear this this top note is it's actually like a trill. So that's sustained up there. And the way that cinematic strings works, you actually use the modulation wheel to control the volume of the note, which is nice because it means you can do swells and things like that. But that just leads nicely from the intro into the drop of the tune. Makes a change from white noise and kind of vengeance sweeps. The intro as well, like at the very start, where you got the harp and the celeste, there's a little kind of little atmospheric noise over the top of that, which is, it's basically a combination of a train station recording and vinyl crackle. But low cut to 3.5K. So you just get the very, very top kind of hiss and crackle of that. And it just sits over the intro really nicely and runs all the way through the tune, right the way to the outro. It's really subtle, it's really quiet, but if you take it out, it kind of, it leaves everything sounding a little bit sterile. So that's with it and without it. Really, really quiet, very subtle, but something that I really like to do on tracks, almost everything that I do these days has something in the background, whether it's like a train station field recording or like underwater recordings, like audio recordings from scuba dives. Get them, you can find them all over the place online. And yeah, high pass them to get rid of all of the kind of mid-range and rumble and stuff. And what you're left with is just tiny little pops and clicks and crackles and bubbles. And it's strange, but if you have it quiet enough so that you don't really kind of tell what it is, it just sits on top of everything and gives everything just a bit of, I don't know, a bit of realness. So yeah, on here it's the train station, other tunes, it's, yeah, dolphins or something. And then kind of going through the vocal, I guess, is the next kind of big element. I recorded that here. It's not the perfect room for recording, but I use like a reflection filter around the mic, which gets rid of so much of the room acoustic. Does a really good job and is a lot cheaper than building a booth. Lily came down. I'd written the sketch. She had a listen to it, had a few ideas. We sat down and kind of worked through the vocals to get something that we were both happy with, and then recorded it in just a couple of hours. So this is the original vocal project, where we recorded all of the vocal parts. So I just had the original track up as a bounce. Just tends to be easier if you want to move sections around in the recording process. Sometimes you want to, you know, double up a section or get rid of a section. It's a pain to do that if you've got the whole project loaded up with all the individual parts. So just loading up a bounce tends to be easier to work with. Everything recorded in, keeping kind of original takes as much as possible rather than comping together, you know, individual words and phrases. You get much nicer flow from kind of one line to the next if it's all sung as one. If the singer can deliver, sometimes, you know, you're working with a singer who can't necessarily deliver an entire verse in one go and nail it all, in which case, you know, comping together is obviously what needs to be done there. But I like when it's possible, try and keep things as kind of one solid element. Nice thing about Cubase, wasn't very necessary with this, but the Very Audio on vocals is fantastic. It's basically kind of like a Melodyne type editor. So once you've analysed the pitch on a monophonic part, it's one thing that you can't do is deal with polyphony. But if you've got a monophonic vocal recording or something like that, move things around, something like this, you know, if you felt that
it was cold, spring, it was cold.
If you wanted a bit less vibrato, you can just kind of bring the straight pitch down.
It's cold.
You still get the amplitude modulation that you get from vibrato. But it's great. It's really nice to be able to grab something like this and you can just straighten the pitch, which just snaps, obviously moves everything like this. If you go all the way, you get the full auto-tune T-Pain effect. But quantized pitch also moves every note to the kind of, to the nearest semitone, basically. And it kind of approximates what it thinks is an individual note or a word or whatever it is, and then takes like an average pitch for each of those blocks. So when you're moving that onto B flat there, but obviously that first little kind of lump at the start jumps up. So sometimes with that, you know, you might need to just do this.
rein it in a little bit. It's nice. You don't want to go overboard with it, or maybe you do if you want that kind of, if you want that as an effect. For a vocal like this, there was very little that I needed to do. There's just the odd little thing where you've got a great delivery, but one note's maybe very, very slightly flat, and you can just nudge it up. It's also really useful, I've found, with if you take a sample or a recorded part and it's out of tune, but you can't work out quite by how much, your ear sometimes is hard to kind of pick up. And if you analyze and get your little, click on a little block, and up at the top here, it'll tell you, so this is currently G sharp 2 plus 12%. So that's 12 cents sharp at the moment. And then if you needed to kind of pitch a whole part or a whole element down, up or down by, you know, a few cents, this will tell you exactly how far out you are, which can just save a lot of bother and a lot of kind of messing around with retuning things, trying to work out if you're quite right. But this is probably one of the elements of Cubase, at least kind of editing in Cubase, that I find most valuable. The Very Audio is really quite transparent if you use it sparingly, and can salvage a take that otherwise was perfect, but you know, just a couple of tuning issues here and there. So yeah, everything kind of run through here. Like I said, just a little bit of compression and a bit of reverb. I used Isotope Nectar. It's a really nice vocal processing effect. Quite a bit of saturation. Quite a retro vocal delivery, I guess. It's quite kind of 60s, 70s soul, and so a bit of saturation makes sense on that kind of vocal. EQ, quite a push around, where's that, 400 hertz. That just kind of brings out the body of the vocal itself. Compression, like I said, fairly low ratio, 2.5 to 1. De-essed, really important. I don't know why, but I'm really sensitive to vocals that haven't been de-essed. It irritates me. And then, yeah, just a little reverb on the master. So that's the vocal project. And then, as I said, I bounced each of these out as an individual individual track. There's like the harmonies that came out as one.
Please return my mind.
And then the vocal is one, and then the backing vocals, and the reverbed out. That reverb came out as another one as well, separately. And then all of those stems into Cubase. In a way, you're kind of committing yourself to things being the way that they are in this. I kind of like that in a way. It allows me to listen to the song a bit more rather than getting focused on production, or engineering rather. I think it's all too easy, especially with, you know, the numbers of plugins that we all have in our computers. And also the way that, I guess, electronic music has gone in the past few years, that mixed down processing, engineering can all too often take a front seat, and songwriting and composition kind of get shoved to the back. And sometimes I find that if I restrict myself on the engineering side, then I start to listen to things more in terms of music and actual kind of content, rather than getting bogged down with tweaking things by half a decibel here or whatever. The vocal in the tune is pretty dry. There's just a bit of reverb, a bit of compression, not anything particularly special, and then just little touches of delay, kind of automated delay. The only thing that's really kind of processed is the Adlibs track, which has a massive reverb. It's the Roomworks, the kind of built-in Cubase reverb. And that's set to like an 8 or 10 second delay, I think. Decay, sorry. And then it also has the chopper, which is like their kind of volume modulation effect. So just flat, it's like that. That just sits on top. And all the way through the tune, there's little bits of... just little bits of ad-libs with that massive reverb on. There were ad-libs that were delivered as straight-up ad-libs, so we recorded the song, and then afterwards we played it all back, and she just kind of did a little thing over the top. But it just makes it a bit different. And the kind of the side-chaining effect of the chopper, like the volume automation, the ramping, means that it's not just this kind of huge wash of reverb. It gives it a bit more shape. So this ad-lib track is bounced. Bounced with all the reverb, and then the chopper effect, the kind of volume ramping, volume automation, is added afterwards. So, the lead parts, they're kind of jumping around from one area to another, and that's basically a leftover from the way that I ended up arranging the track. The vocal was originally in quite a different order. There was a first verse which I ended up kind of losing because it didn't really kind of introduce the song as well as the section that I ended up using. Something that I've learned from many years of kind of struggling with vocals is that don't be afraid to chop them up, to move them around. Don't take the original recording as gospel. You have to have a kind of open conversation with the vocalist often around this, but sometimes what you think is the first verse is actually a better second verse and vice versa. Something that you think of as a chorus might not actually work as a chorus. Maybe your outro kind of little hook is a stronger chorus, so you need to kind of throw that back earlier in the tune. And that's kind of what's happened with this, that there was a kind of a first verse, a sort of chorus, and then a sort of kind of bridge thing, and then a second verse. And the second verse actually worked really well as the first verse. The what we kind of treated of as the main chorus actually ended up kind of being moved somewhere else. And what you end up with is something that hopefully still flows, but actually makes a bit more sense, at least as a piece of music. Those are the kind of the main music elements. The bass is in here and comes from just a contact double bass from their kind of factory set. And so that goes through a bit of compression. It's high cut at 124. So all of that's taken out before it gets compressed. It's quite a brutal EQ curve there. There's a lot of boosting, not much cutting. Not ideal, but it's the way these things happen sometimes. And then there's just a sub-led over that from Reason. So that's, it's just a really simple patch. Just a sine wave. There's almost nothing going on with that, to be honest. It's low pass because sometimes, bizarrely, sine waves out of the subtractor, at least, have these weird high-end. I don't know if you can hear those, they're quite quiet. But just low pass to get rid of any of that. There's automation on the decay on the amp envelope, just for the sustain notes at the end of the bass line, just to make sure that it matches up with the double bass properly. It's up quite high for most of it, just to give it the kind of solidity. But then on the high notes, it'll just drops down, so it fades away. Rather than EQing the double bass to give it subby weight, because the double bass is a recording of a real double bass, as you move from one multi-sample to the next, you'll find that some of them have different amounts of sub, and bass is so important in drum and bass, obviously. Making sure that solidity is really there without kind of, and you could do it through kind of compression or, you know, slamming it through something, but to be honest, my experience is that just by high passing it a little bit, quite a bit, to get rid of all of the low end, the real low end, and then layering a sub underneath it gives you the most reliable, solid low end. And actually, when you listen to it, the two of them together, you don't hear it hugely when you're listening to those two parts together. When everything's going, when you've got drums and everything going on top, you would struggle to pick out the fact that it's not just a straight, pure double bass with nice bottom end. It just sounds like one thing, you know, stuck together. So then, drums, all important. So everything's coming out of reason with this. So we've got, the track, everything else in the track was so natural with the strings and the celeste and the harp and stuff. I wanted drums that sounded quite easy, comfortable, natural, nothing too harsh, nothing too kind of affected. It's built up mainly around these two re-drums. So these are the kind of little drum sampler machines. And then there's shaker break over the top. And that's swung quite hard, actually. So you can see that's where that 16th would sit. So there's quite a full-on swing on this. And it's a bit more stuttery, which just adds a bit of interest to the beat overall. And there's a few little things on the break itself. So that little element there. So that's like an open hi-hat. The length of these notes determines obviously the length of the sample. It's not a kind of one shot play until it's finished. So on the first beat, you get a full quarter note's worth, and then that's cut by a 16th on the second hit on the fourth beat. It's a subtle little thing, but it just kind of keeps the break pushing forwards. And the samples are from various different places. A few that I've kind of picked up from here and there, a few things from sample packs. Some of them are little elements out of breaks that I've kind of dropped in. None of them are particularly amazing sounds. That's quite a duff kick, really. But it's got a nice kind of realness. The bottom end on it's quite rubbish, but it's what it kind of does in the mid-range, and the room sound of it just makes everything feel a bit liver. What else have we got? So these guys here, looks like they're rooted to something which must be muted, I guess. So they must have been early elements that ended up getting kind of taken out and replaced with something else. So the way these come into everything, some of them will be run through individual channels on the Reason mixer. Some things will go directly into Cubase to get affected in there. Some things will get grouped and then sent into Cubase as a group. It really depends on every individual element. So this lot here, they're running through to a channel. Those were old claps and snares that I was using, but I ended up replacing those. Sorry, I keep playing that. It goes on for ages. Those elements go in here, which, yeah, that goes straight into Cubase. So So that's kind of the kick with more low end, and the snare with kind of bite, and those basically bypass my drum bus. So in Cubase, I've got a drum bus where everything's kind of grouped together, compressed together, and what I do is all of everything except for the big kick and the kind of the snap of the snare go through there. Those bypass and go straight to the master output. And what that means is there's a bit of balancing work to get those right. But it means that all of the kind of all of the detail of the breaks gets kind of glued together. And then the big kick and the big snare are left pretty much natural. What that means is you don't end up kind of squashing your kick and your snare with all of the other kind of shuffly bits and pieces that sit behind it. So this is all the other stuff that gets compressed together.
And you're processing those feeds in Cubase as well?
Yeah. Yeah, so this main mix, whoops, just turn that off. This main mix goes into maximizer, isotope maximizer, which is just kind of, that's catching things. That's not doing an awful lot. That just deals with anything that really kind of jumps out. And then there's another drums bus. So you've got another maximizer. Doing a bit more work there. Nothing too heavy. It's on fast, and the transient recovery's on this, which is a really nice little feature that means that you don't lose any of the transients by limiting. And then there's also this compressor, which I don't think I'm, am I using still? Yeah. That doesn't seem to be doing much. It, that that compresses on it's on a sidechain. I'm not sure what's sending to it. Let's see if I can find it. Okay. So the old snare used to sidechain the main drum bus. So basically, as the, you know, I was saying about the snares that hit, that are outside of the drum bus. I had it set up before so that when the snare hit, the main drum bus would duck down to kind of make space for the snare. But that wasn't really necessary with the snare that I ended up using. So you can, yeah, you can hear how the snare used to sound. But I ended up going with something that's got a bit more kind of pop to it. So, yeah, that's basically the kind of drum bus processing. There's nothing really too hardcore going on in there. But as I said, this is a track where I tried to keep things fairly natural and kind of relaxed. There's a few other elements in Reason as well that I've got muted off at the moment. So that's just a kind of skippy break. That's the original. Just kind of some little breaks left in there, you know, some gaps just to kind of help things swing and push forwards. And the obligatory amen. Can't really get away with that one of those. I find personally, and that's high passed. That's really, really quite fiercely high passed. 2.2k, and then a push up at 22. One of the funny things about Reason I find is that you actually seem to end up using ridiculously large boost and cut figures to get the same kind of effect that you would get in another EQ. Don't know if it's down to the way that they modelled the SSL desk in the mixer. It ends up sounding nice, but often my kind of boosts and cuts in the Reason mixer, if you put them down on paper, they look ridiculous. But yeah, so that's being pushed quite a long way. Let's get that back up. So without that EQ. And that just adds a little kind of sheen on top of everything. Yep, so that's all of that. There's also a shaker in there. And that's a shaker roll sample. Quite a mess. It's normally up there, I think. That's the root note? Oh no, what's the root note? Yeah, that must be the root note up there. And so I'm playing it down here. It's pitched down quite a lot. But using some automation on the master level. Again, it's a subtle element, but just kind of adds shape to everything, a bit of, I don't know, I like it when not everything's completely quantized. And the nice thing about that is that it's not a quantized element at all. The sample itself is really loose, but by automating the master level, you get shape from it. It kind of, it comes in when it's supposed to come in, disappears when it's supposed to disappear. And so what you end up with is something that's not a complete mess, but adds a little bit of realism, a bit of shuffle, a bit of chaos, basically, into the whole thing. And then there's just the last elements really are just a few kind of rides. Nothing special. Yeah, like some reverse cymbals, crashes and stuff, the usual kind of thing. Basically anything to kind of add a bit of push and a bit of tension and just the usual stuff that you find at kind of 16s and at drops and breakdowns and things, but without doing white noise or kind of ring mod synth risers and stuff. It's kind of done for me, at least. And so just finding more natural ways to give that effect, but with something that's a bit more real.
Cubase is very popular among DME producers. I know a bunch that use Logic, and Ableton is popular as well. But I don't know whether it's just word of mouth. I think people take recommendations to heart with a lot of these things, and I just got into it because it made sense to me. At the time, Logic seemed quite illogical for a lot of things. Cubase, I've never had to struggle to find out how to do what I want to do in Cubase. Occasionally, when a new feature comes in, I have to kind of look into it a bit. But for the most part, things are very, very straightforward. And I managed to find my route to the kind of end result without too much trouble. So I have a new album, came out in November, called Future History. It's out on Hospital Records. It's basically the sound of me kind of exploring all the sounds, influences that have gone into kind of making me who I am as a producer. So there's elements of kind of early jungle, there's elements of kind of millennium, kind of 2002, 2003, soulful liquid DMB. There's bits that are kind of, you know, taking it right up to date. There's everything kind of in between. It's basically my idea is that here's a little kind of time capsule for the future. Making the album was really fun. It was fast. In previous albums have taken me maybe 12, 18 months to write, and this one took 4, pretty much from start to finish. And I think some of that's down to the fact that I did the new Logic album with my brother a year and a half or so ago, and we did that in 4 months. Basically by kind of going into the studio at 9 o'clock every day and working until 7 o'clock at night for 4 months straight. And unless we were traveling to a gig, we were in the studio. And so I did the same thing with this, and it came really easily, really naturally. It's funny how these things work, that sometimes you can go in the studio for hours and hours and days on end and not go anywhere. And other times, you know, you just go in and it happens. Like towards the end of the album, we realized that there was kind of one more tune that was needed kind of to fill a bit of a stylistic gap. And the deadline was basically the following week. And I came back from a meeting at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon and went into the studio. And by 9 o'clock that evening, I'd sent over the tune to the label. And they were like, yeah, great, job done. So sometimes, you know, when you need to, when you're up against the wall, that's when kind of things come out. So I've got a few groups running in Cubase. Loopy elements, music, drums, bass, vocal group, and lead sub. So it's a subgroup for the lead. And that just runs to a delay before it goes through an EQ. I don't know quite why I've got a subgroup. I might have been doing processing on that more processing at an earlier stage. Sometimes I kind of
will process things and then decide that I've gone too far and end up deleting stuff. And so sometimes you end up with slightly weird routing as a kind of relic of older processing. But essentially, yeah, so there's a music group, drums group, bass and vocal group. The loopy elements, so the original sample that I played at the very, very start of the harp and the celeste had a really nice sound to it. And when I created my version of it, didn't quite sound right. So I just used, Isotope has the equalizer has snapshots. So you can take a snapshot of your recreation, take a snapshot of the original, and then you can match, use one as a reference and apply like an EQ curve. So with the EQ, and without the EQ, so you can hear it's quite a radical difference. But it made sense for what I wanted to do. To be honest, most of those other groups don't really have much processing on them at all. There's a bit of the envelope shaper on the drum channel. So in the channel strip, you know, you've got the gate compressor, envelope shaper, saturation limiter. And I tend to just have a little bit of attack. So it's like a transient shaper, transient designer. And so there's just 1.4 dBs of boost on the attack. Fairly short length, 75 milliseconds. And that just gives you extra bit of snap. It's really easy to go overboard with that. So I'm kind of always a bit wary of that. The maximizer I've shown you. Just kind of catching things, anything that really jumps over. And then bass, there's no processing on that group. That's just the combination of the double bass and the sub. So all that's really doing there, it's allowing me to have control over the volume of those two elements. To be honest, that's a large part of the reason that I group things. I do a bit of kind of bus processing, depending on the tune. Sometimes it's more marked and there's more substantial kind of processing on the buses. But a lot of the time, it's just to allow me to balance the elements when it comes to kind of mixing things down. It's a lot nicer to move one fader than six. Vocal group. Low cut, 173. And then I don't think there's anything else really on that group. Gentle EQ. And an effect send out to a delay. And the lead sub is the same thing, nothing much else apart from a bit of delay. So in terms of kind of bus processing, there's not an awful lot going on. On the master bus, another ozone equalizer. So I have a reference that is basically like an averaged EQ spectrum plot of all the other tracks on the album, a bunch of other tracks that I rate by producers that I respect. And then I use that as a reference curve, basically just to make sure that tunes that I write aren't way, way off. Sometimes you can go in the studio and you can think something sounds amazing. you listen to it compared to everything else and it's really dull or it's really toppy or whatever. So this is a way to just kind of avoid that. And all this is doing, you can kind of control the smoothness with it like that. Then you're going to get a very, very spiky, detailed, but strange sounding EQ curve all the way up to here. You know, a full smoothness. It's very, very subtle. I tend to have it kind of somewhere around here, 0.6, 0.7. And so it's just giving a little push down at the very, very low end. A little dip up here, kind of around, you know, 5 and 10K, and a little push up again at about kind of 17. And that just... No. Give it back to me. Turn that off. Please return my mind. I sleep restlessly. So you can hear the main difference from that actually is that I've got this 3 dB cut on the input just to bring things under control a bit. This isn't what love defined. If I turn the amount down, you'll be able to hear the difference. Give it back to me. Please return my mind. So you know, it's not doing an awful lot, but one of the nice things about this is sometimes if you use this technique, you can see, and it's kind of like using a spectrum analyzer, where you can see where something's not quite right. Sometimes you'll notice that this EQ is, you know, pushing, I don't know, 500 hertz a lot because you've got a big gap in your tune at 500 hertz, or it's cutting it loads because you've got something that's way, way too prominent in that frequency range. I'm always wary of being ruled by these things. It's very easy to take like a spectrum analyzer or something like this as gospel, and you know, you look at it and you see that there's a big peak there, and so something must be wrong. But if I listen back to tunes that I rate by producers that I rate, you know, sometimes from a long time ago, you often find that there's all kinds of elements that are technically wrong, but they make sense in the context of the tune. Always let the music, you know, lead these things, I think. So there's that, and then I always have another instance of ozone, the full thing. You've got an EQ in there, and there's no reason why you can't do the EQ that I did in this standalone equalizer within here. The reason that I have that is because you can move drag and drop presets around, change the order, and I always, whenever I'm getting the snapshot of my tune to compare with the reference, I always do it after my master bus processing so that you're getting the full picture basically. But in the full ozone, there's a little bit more EQ shaping. And we're talking just 1 dB boost and cut there. The harmonic exciter, I like to use that here and there. I don't tend to make my tunes too bright if I can help it, but it's nice to kind of open up and give a bit more air on the top end. Dynamics tends to kind of end up squishing drum and bass a bit too hard if you're not careful, multiband dynamics. But I tend to use them just on the low end, kind of 200 hertz odd down, just a fast attack and fairly quick release, just to basically kind of bring the low end under control. I think unless you're side chaining your kick and your sub against each other, you need to do that because you just get these huge peaks from the sub and the kick hitting at the same time. Stereo imaging, a bit more width. The tune's fairly stereo already. It doesn't need a huge amount, but that just kind of opens things out a bit further. And then on the maximizer, that's working pretty hard. to be honest. But we're getting, on average, like 4 or 5 dB of limiting there, and it's on quick. I've got on very fast character, and transient recovery is up to 100. Can be tempting to push that up to 200, but you get some weird kind of clicky artifacts as a result of that. We like it loud in DMB, like most electronic music. But I think I'm still looking at only about kind of 9 dB as far as the, -9 as far as the kind of average loudness over a long period goes. So I'm not pushing things that hard compared to probably a lot of people. Other things in the mastering chain, the new gen visualizer. A really nice spectrum analyzer. You can do it real time like this, but I find it quite useful to put it on the average time, leave it playing for a little while, and you get a good picture of what the tune looks like over a kind of sustained period. Again, shows you dips, troughs, and things like that. And then this thing here, Magic AB, really simple plugin that allows you. Allows you to just AB between tunes. I always find it really important in the production process to cross-reference. Like I was saying before, your ears can get tired, mine can play tricks on you. And so kind of jumping around, everything on here, almost everything on here is tunes by me, tunes from the album. It's useful within the album process where you want to get some kind of coherence across a project, to be able to just jump from one thing to another. You can do it without a plugin, but I just like this because it allows me to do it. Like, I have this saved as a preset, so I start a new project on the album, load this up, and then I've got all the other album tracks there ready to go. And you can just flick. Just kind of helps you get a picture.